In 2013, whilst living in Kenya, I met these two ladies who'd been waiting to see me in an eye clinic where I'd been providing various eye treatments and services. The amazing thing about these two ladies is they'd previously been the best of friends who had become separated because they'd both lost their sight. They'd lost their sight to a condition known as cataract, which is the leading cause of blindness in the world, despite it being completely treatable in under 10 minutes for less than $50. Now, these two ladies represent many, many millions of people worldwide who've unnecessarily been living with sight loss, and they would, in epidemiological terms, be considered a group who have an unmet need. There are also many millions more, in fact, billions around the world who live with refractive error, in other words, the need for a pair of glasses, like myself. Many of them have been corrected, but yet it's currently thought that over 1 billion people today still can't access a pair of glasses. So, although this young girl has had her need met, there are many more who still are waiting for that to be met. And so we can broadly think of these three categories of people in the population: those with an unmet need, a met need, and no need. The recent World Report on Vision by the WHO in 2019 reported the latest global figures on vision. And what it showed was of the 7.6 billion people living on the planet, over 1 billion still today live without access to basic vision correction that could completely transform their lives. So if we look at the causes of those people, that 1 billion people who are living with poor vision, the absolute majority either just need a simple pair of glasses, which is a 700-year-old innovation, or cataract surgery, a procedure that has been honed and refined over the last several decades to be very affordable and of extremely high quality. But if we look at the distribution of where people who are living without access to these conditions are, it's predominantly in low and middle income countries. So 89% of people living with vision loss today live in a low or middle income country. And you can see on this map that has been distorted to show where the numbers are greatest in terms of people living with vision loss, that it's in sub-Saharan Africa and Asia. But if you look at where the eye care providers are, the ophthalmologists, they're predominantly in countries like in the continents of Europe and America. So we see this huge inequity between those who can provide services and those who need it. And so the challenge that we have is how do we access people like this lady who's unnecessarily been blind for 10 years, and how do we ensure young children in school as well as older adults who are needing glasses are able to access them. So we have to consider a population perspective when we do this. And usually, when designing a program, our focus is on how do we address the unmet need in that population. And so it's important that we measure what matters in a program. So the first thing we do is determine of that population for whom this program is designed, what proportion have an eye health need, and then how many of those with an unmet need move to having their need met. And we found there to be three indicators in programs that are more sensitive than anything else for measuring that. The first is the screening coverage. What proportion of people who have a problem in the population are identified? Now, that may either be through sensitization, so they've been made aware that they have a problem, through campaigns, through education, and therefore they turn up at the health centre. Or it could be through proactive screening, actually going out into the community, finding people and bringing them to a health centre or service. So in this example, where the screening coverage is at 80%, we can see of that population where 100 had an unmet need, we've now identified 80 of them. But identifying them is only the first part of the journey. Once identified, they have to actually arrive at the place for which they can receive a service. And in this example, where the referral adherence to the service is 50%, which we found in practice is actually very high, many reports of it being typically in the 10-20% bracket. Here you can see of the original 100 with an unmet need, now 40 of them have received a service. And then the final indicator is how effective has that service been? So if they've received treatment, how many of them went on to have their need actually met? And in this example, where the service was 75% effective, we can see 30 have now moved from the unmet need category to the met need category. And service effectiveness here can be from, if we look at our specific examples in eye care, cataract surgery, the surgery actually working and them getting the desired vision, or if it's wearing glasses, if they're given glasses, do they actually wear them? There can be lots of compliance issues around social stigma related to wearing them. And so we can see in this total population that had 100 people with an unmet need here, 30% has been met. So if we want to change that picture, the thing we need to really do is focus particularly on those who are being left behind. So in this day and age of universal health coverage, we're not just talking about who gets there, but how do we ensure nobody is left behind? And so we have to actually understand who is being left behind and what's specific to them. So if we look at some eye care examples here, what are the things that are meaning people have lower access to services? So one simple way of breaking this down is to look at the A, B, C, D, E, F, G of access. So the first is around awareness. So which people in the population are actually aware that their vision loss is something that could be treated? Many people will live with sight loss not knowing that they can actually receive a treatment. B is for bad services. So that would mean people for whom they have gone to a clinic or a service, but they've had to queue for hours, and when they get to the front of the queue, the person they need to see is not available. C is costs, both the direct and indirect cost of treatment. Often there's lots of hidden costs in the system, from your booking cost to your treatment cost to your payment for supplies, and all of that can be very prohibitive. The distances people have to travel, particularly in places where infrastructure is minimal, where there may not be road access, can really prevent people actually being able to physically access the services they need. E is for escorts, which is particularly pertinent in eye care, where if somebody is blind, they'll need to depend on somebody else who has good vision to guide them to the services and be there with them. And if you've lived with sight loss for a long time and with it lost your independence, you'd be very reluctant to access services if there isn't somebody with you. So from a service provider perspective, the escort needs to be thought of as part of the community for whom this service is being delivered. F is for fear. A lot of fear is understandable around the prospect of having some kind of procedure related to your eye. And if there isn't the time given for good counselling and education, then fear can become a major barrier which will prevent people coming to access services. And gender. The data shows us that women and girls are disproportionately affected by all of these barriers than men and boys. And so if we're to focus on our group with an unmet need and their barriers, it helps us to understand what is it that is stopping them going from unmet need to met need. And by doing so, we can start to target our interventions in a program to focus on that group. So here in this example, we can see 50% of the people being found are not turning up at the services. And so we'd be interested to understand, what can we do to change that? How do we go about changing that referral adherence? In other words, when we find someone, removing their barriers that stop them actually accessing the service. And this is where data can be hugely valuable. So if here we start to look at this by gender, you can start to see that the breakdown of those who are turning up versus not turning up by gender shows a huge equity gap. So many more women are dropping out between being found and turning up at the services versus men. And so what that means is that information needs to be translated into an insight, which needs to be translated into a practice. That can be anything from providing specific sensitization or education or targeted services to women in the community to try and lower the barrier for them to come. Obviously, it's always very context specific, so these solutions always need to be locally driven and locally hypothesized in terms of how to overcome them. In this example, if we're able to increase the referral adherence from 50% to 75%, so a 25% gain, the number of people who are being found stays at 80, but in terms of those turning up, goes from 40 now to 60. And the number, therefore, who are getting an effective outcome is now 45. So we get a 50% increase overall in terms of addressing the unmet need. And so if we are going to strive towards leaving no one behind and universal health coverage, We need to actually be able to see the health system so that we can drive change within it. And so what we've been doing over the last 7 or 8 years is developing evidence-based solutions to provide local healthcare providers with data-driven solutions to meet the needs of their population. We've done this by developing mobile applications such as a validated vision test that can be delivered by anyone in any setting and in any language. This is now being delivered in community-based programs, in school-based programs across different countries in Africa and Asia. And at every point that that patient who's been now identified encounters the health system, so whether it's a primary health centre or the hospital, their data is captured as they move through their journey from being found to receiving treatment and followed up to see the outcome of that treatment. Programme implementers are able in real time to track the progress of the population through the system. The analytics give them a rich set of data from understanding who's been found out of the target population, how many have made it to their appointments, how many have not made it, what's the difference between the groups, what treatment have they needed, what have they received or not received. We can also see it geospatially, so we start to understand per location, is there a specific activity or change in practice there that program managers need to be aware of? And we can drill down to the very specifics of every person's encounter with the system. Now, the value of data has to be linked to the leadership within that program, and the leadership needs to translate the data into practice. And to do that, there needs to be equity baked into the system by design. And so what that means is using the data to drive a change of practice. So I'm going to give you a specific example here. In a recent study undertaken by our group at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, two cross-sectional surveys from Nigeria and Sri Lanka were undertaken. And it was looking specifically at cataract services, so the leading cause of blindness worldwide. And basically what both studies showed was that of the people who were blind in the population, more than half in both Nigeria and Sri Lanka came from a subgroup of women who were unmarried, predominantly widows. However, that subgroup made up less than 1 in 5 of the total population. So less than one in five of the total population was leading to more than half of the overall blindness in that population. So if we try and look at that graphically, there was a fairly even gender split between male and female. So male here being blue, female being orange. So 51-49%. However, of the women, a subgroup were unmarried, predominantly widows here who are purple. Yet the number of people who were blind, you can see affected that subgroup more than anyone. So those marked red here. So unmarried women were the majority of those who were blind in the total population, leading to accounting for more than half. So if we want to understand why is it that subgroup is not getting access to services, it's helpful to understand the reality on the ground for what this means. And it comes down to the barriers that they face. So we discuss those barriers from A to G that different groups face when trying to access services. Those barriers are higher for that subgroup. And we can think of it in terms of the challenge of low-hanging versus high-hanging fruit. To overcome those barriers, it takes greater cost, greater infrastructure to overcome them. And if you look at the analogy of low-hanging fruit, which, for example, in cataract services would be accessing the men in the city who are educated and don't have the same barriers, that's the low-hanging fruit. So if you want to get high numbers in your program, that's who to focus on, that's who to design for. But if you want to get the high-hanging fruit, in other words, the unmarried women who are more difficult to reach in the rural locations, you've got to build different ladders. You've got to build different systems to access them. Part of the problem that we have in terms of how programs are remunerated and are supported through various different mechanisms mean the numbers matter. So in this top example, the low-hanging fruit is gathered quickly. So 60 were left behind, but 60 were picked. in this bottom example, in the same time it took as the top three trees to get the low-hanging fruit, one tree was fully picked. But that meant 80 were left behind and 40 were picked. So if, for example, the funding in a program is driven by getting as many as quickly as possible, it's hard to design for the high-hanging fruit. However, when you do build systems and ways of working that account for the high-hanging fruit as well, you get the high-hanging and the low-hanging, which means you don't leave anyone behind. And so what we're advocating for here is systems that are designed to meet the needs of everyone. However, short-term, they may not yield the same kind of results as if you build those longer-term systems. So what does that look like in practice? What does the data show us? Well, if you track that group through, what is the reason they're dropping out is from the total population of people with an unmet need, you see who are not being found or for whom the educational messaging or screening means they're not being reached are predominantly that subgroup. And then when they're found and referred, they have all these different barriers that are preventing them access the service. But if they actually are able to get the service, they're most likely as equally likely to get a good outcome. So in this example where 28 out of 100 are getting an effective outcome, so having their need met, you can see that those who are being left behind are predominantly made up of those of that unmarried women group. So if programs are designed and systems are built specifically to focus on them, so that may be in terms of the type of messaging at the community level, you see a huge increase in coverage. And then services such as specific transport or bringing services closer to the community to increase adherence is the best way to deliver impact. So an equitable approach leads to a greater proportion of unmet need being met. In this example, it has been doubled. What that means in practice is for those billions of people who are still being left behind, it means we can now start to think of ways of reaching them. So data aligned with an equitable and ethical approach can ensure that women like these two who were being left behind are no longer left behind. Fortunately, after the day we met these two women, they were able to receive cataract surgery. And this is what happened shortly after they had their treatment.